stated in such clear and absolute terms as that ban, that prohibition on torture. Yet, here in Canada and around the world, today we are launching a new 2-year global campaign to stop torture, because torture continues to haunt every corner of our world. And it's my honor to be here today alongside two courageous and resolute torture survivors, both Canadian citizens, who will share their own personal reflections on why this campaign and the struggle to end torture is so vitally important. Hamid Ghashemi-Shal, who has faced torture in Iran, and Roy Samathanam, who hopefully will be joining us in a few moments from Sri Lanka. Routinely, brutally, secretively, brazenly, cruelly, and with impunity, men, women, and young people face the agonizing and debilitating terror of torture every single day on every continent. In fact, our new report, Torture, 30 Years of Broken Promises, notes that over the past 5 years, Amnesty International has documented torture in 141 countries. That's roughly 3/4 of the world's states. And those are only the cases that we are aware of. The real number, the true number, is almost certainly even higher. We are launching the Stop Torture campaign right across Canada today with events from coast to coast. And it's a campaign that will remind the public and will certainly remind governments that torture is a disgraceful human rights crisis that can and must be stopped. In the 1980s, an earlier Amnesty International campaign propelled governments to strengthen the international legal ban on torture by adding a new treaty to the international human rights system, the UN Convention Against Torture. That convention could not be more explicit and forceful in its message that nothing ever justifies torture. And now, 30 years later, 155 countries around the world have taken the pledge, have signed on and bound themselves to that treaty, binding themselves to the obligation to end torture within their own borders and around the world. That's impressive, 155 countries, but well over half of those countries continue to order, promote, encourage, allow, or turn a blind eye to torture. That is unacceptable. 30 years on, we cannot stand by and allow this precious promise, this bedrock human rights obligation, to be so regularly and viciously betrayed, and integrity on which the entire concept and system of human rights protection rests. Allowing torture deepens divisions and leaves behind a growing list of victims and survivors. It maims, it wounds, it dehumanizes, it traumatizes, and it kills. What is torture's legacy? Individuals are brutalized, families are terrified, communities are terrorized into silence, and in the end, torture only lays the ground for more and more human rights violations. That is why governments knew there could be no exceptions. No exceptions because torture doesn't work. People will say anything, confess to anything, to bring the agony of torture to an end. No exceptions as well, because torture doesn't stop. There is no such thing as just a little bit of torture. Once it is allowed against anyone, it can and will be used against anyone. The torturer's reach only expands. It does not stay confined. Amnesty International has seen that, has documented that everywhere that torture rears its ugly head. Be complicit in torture in other countries. That must finally be addressed and resolved. And that certainly includes the recent disturbing revelations of ministerial directions issued to such agencies and departments as CSIS, the RCMP, the Canadian Border Services Agency, the Canadian Security Establishment, and the military authorizing complicity in torture in our intelligence relationships with other countries. Those agencies are given the green light to make use of intelligence that was likely obtained through torture in other countries. They are also allowed to provide intelligence information to foreign agencies, even if that is likely to cause torture in other countries. That's not acceptable. We will also be highlighting how vital and how long overdue it is for Canada to sign on to an important UN Torture Prevention Treaty, the optional protocol to the Convention Against Torture. The treaty sets up a system for inspecting detention centers to spot the conditions that breed torture. It has been around for almost 12 years now, and Canada hasn't signed on yet. More than 70 countries are on board, including many of our close allies. We cannot credibly push countries with records of rampant torture. We can't credibly push Iran to sign on to this important treaty until we have done so ourselves. The bottom line is this: torture can and must be stopped, but it will take commitment, leadership, and action. Throughout the campaign, we will push governments to put in place the safeguards needed to prevent torture so that lawyers, doctors, investigators, oversight bodies, the courts, and others are able to play their crucial role in preventing torture. And we will demand that the impunity that has long protected torturers comes to an end. If torturers do not face justice, if torturers are not held accountable, of course then, torture will only continue. And as long as torture continues anywhere, we all remain diminished by it, and we all remain vulnerable to it. Torture can, torture must be stopped. And I'd now like to welcome Hamid Ghashemishal to share a few personal thoughts as we launch this campaign.
Thank you, Elvis. Thank you very much. As a lot of people would know that my story, what happened to me, I was subject to torture, me and my brother, back in Iran. And as a result of tortures, my brother, my older brother, he lost his life, and he couldn't survive. And I want to thank Amnesty International for starting this campaign, and I want to congratulate them. It's a very good campaign. There's a lot of potential there. We can start from Canada. Canada has a lot of potential to stop the torture through their allies that they're subjecting their own citizen to torture to stop this inhumane act. No human being deserves to be subject to torture. And the torture, the side effect of the torture affects the society, affects the family, affects the children of the society. That when somebody is subject to torture at the workplace, in the family, they affect their own wife, parents, brother and sister. And I believe that we have to support this campaign to stop the torture, right from Canada, worldwide, to support the other group to stop this campaign. To support this campaign to help to prevent torture in the countries. And as the Iran goes, I was witness of a lot of torture for myself and the other fellow prisoners. Most of them, they were subject to torture, beating, handcuffing, blindfold most of the time during the interrogation, and so on and so forth. So is their family. Their family, they were threatened. You know, it's a kind of a torture. Torture is not supposed to be all the time physical. The psychological way of torturing is much more worse than physical torture. And imagine the family that they went through. My wife Antonella, she went through the torture, psychological torture, while she was fighting for my release. And, you know, This is, I believe this is a very good campaign, and I'm supporting it with all my heart, and I'm gonna be behind Amnesty International, especially Canada, to stop this this inhumane act. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hamid. Our third speaker, unfortunately, is not yet here with us. He may yet still arrive, and I'm sure certainly will be prepared and willing to make some comments at that time. But at this point, if anyone had any questions that they wanted to ask, can certainly open it up to that.
Report on Indigenous or Native Canadian. So. Somehow, because they are suffering on the issue in Canada, so Amnesty Canada, what does do to help implement the United Nations report?
We certainly welcomed very much the report from the Special Rapporteur, James Anaya, yesterday, and have followed very closely his mission and the work that led up to this report. I wish I could say that we were surprised to see what was in the report. Clearly we were not. It was strong affirmation, very powerfully compiled and expressed of the range of very serious human rights concerns that Amnesty International and so many other organizations have spoken about with respect to Indigenous peoples in Canada for many years now. But I think it's very important that we have such an authoritative report in front of the country now, laying out concerns with respect to violence against Indigenous women, failure to properly protect land and resource rights, the disregard for the important Indigenous right of free, prior, and informed consent, a whole host of concerns associated with equality rights for Indigenous people, Indigenous children, issues around the justice system and the policing system, poverty-related concerns. It's a long list. But I think perhaps equally and more important, really, is the fact that he has put in front of governments, because it's not just about the federal government, it's of course about action at all levels. He has put in front of governments in Canada the recommendations that would take us forward, human rights-based recommendations that would begin to address these long-standing concerns, and now, of course, we need to see action.
Alex, are you surprised that we are in 21st century and we have to keep talking about torture and how even Western countries that seem decades ago were serious against fighting torture. Seems that they are stepping back from that fight. Are you surprised that we are in this situation?
Clearly, Amnesty International is disappointed that there's still at this point in 2014 is the need for such a high-profile and concerted campaign to tackle such a long-standing human rights concern, and a human rights concern that has such obvious solutions to it. And we are particularly distressed, and I think one of the many reasons why we decided to mount the campaign at this point in time is that over the last 10 plus years since September the 11th, we obviously have witnessed some setbacks. Clearly it has been disappointing to see countries like the United States, which at one point led many of the global efforts to secure strong prohibitions on torture, to really lead global efforts to try to eradicate torture, not only back away from that, but actually start to be a country responsible for some of the insidious ways in which the ban on torture was being undermined. So part of this campaign is about renewing that sense of global purpose, of reminding all governments, north and south, east and west, rich and poor, no matter what their political makeup is, that this is a fundamental, shared, universal obligation that all countries must be part of protecting, a human rights crisis that all governments must help to solve, and that we can't continue to certainly see an erosion, but that we certainly cannot continue to also see failure to take the positive steps that are necessary to finally relegate torture to the dustbins of history.
And if I can ask you one more question, what has been, in your opinion, the consequences of countries like United States, Canada, or Europe awakening their stand against torture in other countries in the last decade?
Throughout the past 13 years now, I guess, almost 13 years since September the 11th and all that was unleashed after that, we have highlighted that when countries like the United States, Canada, and other Western governments were weakening their stand against torture, that that was bad news for two reasons. Number one, obviously, it was bad news for the individuals and families and communities who were directly impacted, who were the ones ending up in the torture chamber, either through direct or indirect action by those governments. But we also highlighted the fact that that was setting a global stage which really conveyed a sense of permission to other governments to follow suit. Other governments which before might have been worried about being criticized because they were allowing or encouraging or even directly ordering torture, knew that maybe now they would get a free ride. And we certainly saw that not only with respect to torture, but a whole range of human rights concerns. That as that strong voice started to be muffled in terms of speaking out against torture and other serious human rights concerns, so many other governments were feeling that they had carte blanche in ways that they hadn't previously. So it's both crucial that all governments.
Okay, Alex, you have a lot of experience on human rights and working with Amnesty. You know that it is very narrow line between human rights and political human rights, particularly in some countries such as Middle East, such as Iran, and some advocate of human rights in Canada. They are politicizing the human rights in Iran. So that's why the Iranian regime doesn't budge to the any pressure from outside, because they are telling that, okay, this guy is just doing criticizing just us. For instance, they don't criticize, not you, criticizing Saudi Arabia or Israel on the Palestinian side, or Turkey on Kurdish side, or anything else. You know, that is all of the countries in that area, they do not have that much a good record of the human rights. So it is very important. How do you advise for the communities to help Amnesty to spread the word of stop torture, and how to, because for instance, the Iranian judiciary said last week in an interview, don't blame us, the United States is torturing in Guantanamo Bay. So, I mean, that they make an excuse because somebody else doing that one, they said, okay, why you don't tell anybody to them? So, but in reality, torture is torture. So with your experience, strong experience, how do you advise to the communities and human rights activists?
Well, Amnesty International's message to all Canadians, including Iranian Canadians and members of other ethnic communities within Canada, is that the best way to make a concerted contribution to ending torture anywhere and everywhere is to become part of this important campaign over the next 2 years. This will give an opportunity to take the issues out of that political context and put them firmly, squarely in a human rights context. There will be nothing about this campaign at any turn that directly or indirectly talks about politics. Everything will be focused on the fact that torture, wherever it occurs, whichever government is responsible for it, is wrong, is illegal, and must end. And that here are the concrete steps, the legal measures, the safeguards that need to be taken, that need to be put in place towards that goal. So I think the message is welcome to this unfortunate but very necessary and crucially important campaign to stop torture. This offers the best opportunity to make a difference toward that crucial goal.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dilip Chalwal. I'm also one of the living examples, like my friend from Iran. I have been brought in here 25 years back, exactly on June 24th. I'm completing 25 years. Amnesty International from UK Ingram, I think she's still there in Internal Security. She who contacted me and intervened in my case after the killing of my son and my father within 2 weeks' time because of me. I was again missed back home editing a daily paper. My experience is different. I underwent problem with Sri Lankan Armed Forces and again with Indian Armed Forces. Both arrested me in different time and they tortured me for more than 82 days continuously. So thank God to Amnesty International. I go to Amnesty International. So wholeheartedly I support this project. But my only request is, Sri Lanka is also one of the worst countries these days. Even this morning I read some stories because the Mullivaikal 5th anniversary is coming on the 18th of this month. A lot of arrests going on. They are arresting and harassing a lot of people, innocent people. Torture is going on without any interference from any part of the world. Right? So I personally feel this type of projects should go to the Tamil community, not only Tamil community, all the ethnic groups. Right? So is there any way the Amnesty Toronto office can work out through my friend? He is very good support with the Tamil community, always being in the community functions. There are, we have 3 24 hours Tamil television stations. We have 6 24 hours Tamil radio stations. In addition, we have 17 weekly papers. Some articles or some interviews in our own language towards this project, because it's going to be for 2 years, right? So it has to go to the ethnic groups here, not only the mainstream. So this is fundamental question.
And we couldn't agree with you more. And thank you, number one, for sharing your own personal story, but also for highlighting that for you, Amnesty International played such a crucial role. I think that is an important reminder for us as we move into this campaign. It's a very personal reminder, and we heard it from Hamid Ghashemi Shal as well, that ordinary people coming together, the intervention of a group like Amnesty International, even in the face of something as insidious, secretive, and awful as torture, can and does make a difference. And I couldn't agree with you more, Thiru, with respect to your suggestion that working very closely with community-based ethnic media in the Tamil community, but in fact in a whole range of communities right across Canada, in Toronto and elsewhere, is vitally important, and I can assure you it's actually going to be one of the centerpieces of our media strategy with respect to this campaign. We do want to be in those community papers. We do want to be on those community television stations, welcoming those communities to join us in this campaign. And we think that the message, the objectives of this campaign will really resonate so strongly at that level, because we'll be reaching audiences who sadly, more directly and personally than many others in Canada, really understand and recognize what the crisis of torture is all about, what the cost of the failure to address torture is, and also therefore I think will be compelled, will respond to that call that is at the heart of this campaign to join in. Use your voice, speak out, and make sure we do everything we can to end torture around the world. So thank you.
Thank you. All right.